Welcome to a brand new episode of Sequel Rights, the podcast where we take a look at franchises that make you go, they made how many of those? And we give each and every sequel a fair trial. My name is Justin Camps, and I'm here with
Elizabeth Helly
and
Tyler P. Word Hymanson.
Oh, don't say it. Don't say the word. We don't say that word around here. We just don't, okay? Welcome, everybody, to the final Sequel Rights episode of 2020. We're done. We're done with this year. We're over it. Ready to move on.
After this year, I do feel like if you wanted to really truncate the experience of 2020, all you'd have to do for all of the horrible hours and uncertain times that we've gone through is just mainline eight Beethoven films. I feel like that's the drudgery that we have experienced. Mm-hmm. And it feels like the perfect thing to put a bow on this year.
You know, I feel bad. Last week we had the Christmas adventure. I feel bad that there's no New Year's Eve adventure for Beethoven, where he gets drunk at a party and, gets to do the countdown.
He's like pink St. Bernards on parade.
Yeah, or well, he gets to save the ball drop in New York City, you know?
I do hope that all of our acquaintance with this franchise will be forgot. So
Beethoven, the ball is stuck. Jump on it. And, you know, maybe next time they'll do a New Year's Eve adventure. That'll be fun.
Well, this was only 2014. And so though this is the eighth film, I do not feel like that we were done with this franchise.
There's got to be a ninth.
I do feel like at any
Beethoven's
minute,
ninth.
At any minute, I'll be forwarding you guys the trailer for the next Beethoven movie sometime soon. It's going to happen. They're taking their sweet time to think about what to do next.
But for now and for today, we're talking about the eighth Beethoven film that is actually called Beethoven's Treasure Tale.
Yes.
Tale is a pun, but we will probably call it the Treasure Trail the entire
treasure
time.
Trail. Treasure Tale. Treasure Trail. Yes. Pretty exciting. But before we get into the full movie here, Eliz, where can people reach out to us?
Yeah, send us your 2021 franchise ideas to sequelrights@gmail.com. And you can find us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube at Sequel Rights.
Please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts. 5 stars lets more people find the podcast. And that's great for us. And we really appreciate it. Thanks.
That's right. Well, why don't we take a look into seeing what Beethoven's up to this time? Whoops, I pushed the wrong button. Here we go for the trailer.
Beethoven is back in an all-new comedy adventure. Beethoven's Treasure Tale.
Oh, what's he doing in here?
Don't miss your favorite St. Bernard.
Beethoven.
Ooh. When his new home is in trouble.
O'Malley's Cove's gonna go bankrupt.
Who's that?
He's the guy who wants to buy our town.
Saving it will be his biggest adventure yet.
Beethoven's gonna help me find
Captain O'Malley's treasure. And use it to help our town.
I love that final string of dialogue from the kid. They cut together like 6 different things that he says to make it sound like yeah, a total
to make it
robot.
Sound like a coherent yeah. sentence.
What's the deal with towns in Canada just being for sale all the time? Like Schitt's Creek and then this town and
know, it's
our
problem.
Town and yeah, all there. The others.
It's a problem.
I here's the thing that I will say. We're gonna be talking a lot of shit about this movie, but I am impressed with the Beethoven series, how they managed to make the meta Beethoven's big break about him being in Hollywood, transition that to an entirely different family for a Christmas movie, and then bring it back. This movie starts with Beethoven being a star and starring in, like, it might as well be Herbie Goes to Monte Carlo.
Oh my God. It was exactly that.
For the love of Beethoven. Yep. Benji.
Yep. The movie,
they even had a song.
Yeah, the movie starts out and I was like, oh my God, this exact same scene happens in the Monte Carlo Herbie movie.
But they made a 3-movie arc out of this somehow in a way that gave more care to the characters than we usually see. And I did not like this movie, but from a sequel standpoint, it's kind of impressive.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say, I was pretty shocked to see Jonathan Silverman come back.
As was I.
I was not shocked, but furious.
Disappointed.
I
yeah.
I was just like, wait, so what was he doing during the Christmas one? Because it's not like, you know, this one was also shot in Canada, so why didn't they just keep him for that one, too? Why did they, like, make a whole different family and now bring him back? Like, what happened
well,
in that time?
Well, and, like, okay, like, nah, they mentioned okay, his I'm son back. Went to college, and we see a few, like, sad photos of, oh, I missed my son. But, like, what happened to the writer lady? It didn't work out? Like, and we didn't even mention in that episode that that actress is his wife in real life, and they are still married.
I didn't know that.
Today. And so I'm like, what, you couldn't convince your own wife to be in Beethoven's Treasure Tale?
I mean, that makes sense to me, but
they're like, how are we going to make it so that the writer lady lives in O'Malley's Cove now? It makes no sense.
I will say that of all of the sequel movies that we've had, where we've had new characters come in and rotate out or whatever it is, this movie has the most deference for past characters, where our main dog trainer guy gives his son a call and realizes that he has to lie. He's like, I can't tell him that we need him or that I was fired or anything else. She's like, I don't want him to worry. He's over at college. And I actually appreciated, like, the scene is completely worthless.
I thought that was dumb. Yeah.
for anybody else who hasn't watched all of these movies, but we call out all of these sequels for not doing that. And I do think that it is one of the better examples of how you deal with a star leaving and having a character just kind of having a moment to justify their absence. And
but the moment is, like, so cheapened by the fact that he's like, well, how about this bitch with her son? And, like, let me just get a new chick and a new son and I'll just stay here.
Yeah. No, it absolutely is. But I feel like that that moment stood out to me because it's something that we call out every other sequel for not doing, and they at least tried.
I think what we need to do, I don't know about what you guys think about this, but I think that we need to refer to these last three Beethoven films officially as the Dead Parent Trilogy, because there's each movie.
Yep.
One of the parents in a relationship has died. And that's the only reason why so-and-so can fall in love with so-and-so, because the parent's dead or whatever. Yeah, it's so stupid. So stupid.
Yeah. Well,
I was like, why is there yet another dead parent in this?
I would like to go a step further and blame Beethoven for the murder of all of these spouses.
Yeah. He's going, that's how far he goes to set up these relationships. He kills the person.
Well, we saw that he can read contract law, that he can get high school relationships set up, but, you know, as Beethoven ages, he realizes that he can control much more about human interaction. And if he murders spouses, that he can play a much better matchmaker.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he also, like, apparently at some point got rid of his own three kids from the last movie.
That's true.
Right.
Well, okay, like, the four kids from the original two, of course, and now he's had three other kids that are now axed. And at some point, Jonathan Silverman shows him the phone, and it's a picture of Rico, or whatever his name is, Billy, from the last movie, holding one of the puppies. And he's like, wow, Beethoven, I can't believe you were ever that small. It's like, well, yeah, he was, like, biologically, but that's not a picture of him.
Yeah, the puppies just disappear every movie.
Yeah, the single dad nonsense. Well, I mean, look, as we know from our last episode, a St. Bernard puppy makes anything better.
Mm-hmm,
so,
But let's talk about the beginning, because we have some good little cameos in here, at least.
Yeah, so it starts out straight up exactly like, Herbie Goes to Monte Carlo, where there's these two guys like, I have hidden the gem, your special gem in my perfect security building, and look, no one could ever get to it unless they know
and
this
And my
code.
Perfect security building is also in a casino because...
Exactly. And I was just laughing because I'm like, oh my God, this is exactly the same way as they introduced the villains in that movie. I was even like, if Beethoven's suddenly already in the room, then I'm like, someone watched that movie and wrote this movie right afterwards. And he was.
No, Beethoven does a little butt scooch under all the lasers and gets to the parrot pendant, which even though we haven't introduced pirates yet, the diamond thing is a parrot.
I love seeing his paw come up and put in the code and the security thing, like, beep, beep,
yes,
beep, beep.
The actor, Brian George, who was playing the guy that had his diamonds secured there, he actually was the voice of Mr. Hugs with two G's in every episode of Beethoven, the animated series.
Nice. That's cool.
And a crap ton of other things, like... He was like a Kiati Demon D in Clone Wars and like all many roles. But and then what? Morgan Fairchild is the producer. She's in it for about 5 seconds. Colin Mockery is here as our dog therapist that I wish had stayed around longer because I love him. But at least he was like, dude, Beethoven's depressed. You're a piece of shit. Like... You know, and the guy's just like, what? Like, he doesn't get it at all.
He's a dog. Like, yeah, I put him outside. If you recall from the two movies ago, when he had his puppies inside, I kept him outside because that just made sense.
Like, this guy has not grown up, despite the fact that he adopted Beethoven and Beethoven had this relationship with his son. This guy really does still not love Beethoven. He's a job for him. He's a cash cow.
It's true. We can't, before we get into the fact that this is a film set and everything, we can't gloss over the amazing song that kicks off this movie.
Secret Agent Dog.
Oh, God. Yeah. Here, I wrote down. So, yeah, it's a cover. It's a stupid cover of the song Secret Agent Man. And I wrote down the lyrics for the chorus here because it's so genius, you know. I just had to take it down. So, yeah, it goes, secret agent dog, sniffs at the kind of danger that makes the other canines pause. So stupid. Made me want to kill myself.
How is pause spelled?
I couldn't find it actually online, so I'm just assuming it's P-A-W-S, but I don't know. Even though that makes no sense. And then it says, secret agent dog, he's licensed confidential, and he's here to do a job, which is just like the worst lyrics I could imagine. I'm like, I do those dumb parody songs, I feel like I could have made a better
you
thing.
Did.
Oh, you absolutely could.
The love of Benji.
Yeah. Yes.
It was so funny. My wife was watching this with me, and she started watching like right at the scene when he's going under the lasers and it's playing like James Bond music, and she was like, what? No, what is, no, stop it. Why are you watching this?
And you're like, Glory, this is the life I've chosen.
Yep. I'm like, I'm sorry. I didn't know it was going to be like this. So I was somewhat relieved that that was not actually the movie.
To be fair, you knew that Beethoven 8 was going to be exactly like this.
Oh, yeah. I guess it is funny, too, that he's starring in something called like Spy Dogs 3. And I don't remember what the subtitles were. But,
they get fired because Beethoven won't jump off the balcony.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it leads to my new favorite, my new favorite button to push.
Yo, Justin, I'm acting here.
You guys, this is going to be like the new, the new soundbite that we can use for anything like this.
Yo, Justin, I'm
podcasting
here.
It's so versatile. We can put anything in there.
If you recall, last week I watched the wrong movie for about 10 minutes, and I got to that point, and I was in our group Slack. I was like, oh, it's fine, Justin, because I know you were just acting.
Yo.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. I when that happened, it was just like... you know, it makes me think of Rick and Morty and everything. Yeah. I'm walking.
Also, like, are they making fun of Justin Lin?
I don't know. That's what what's crossed my mind too, but
yeah, because there's like an Asian director and they purposely name him Justin, but yeah. I don't know.
2014, yes, probably, yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know. I don't know why they would be making fun of him. He's been the
worst thing
successful.
About this director is that he's an asshole on this set, but the end of this movie is the Beethoven's trainer being like, well, we're just going to make our own movies in O'Malley Cove for some reason. And for whatever reason, they made the director of this movie move out to O'Malley Cove to be a PA.
Yeah.
Serve regular coffee.
I thought that was him at the end. I was like, is that the same guy?
Yeah, it's messed up.
Yeah, oh, yeah. It was an insane joke that made no sense.
You know, then immediately, you know, yeah, so he gets fired off the set. And immediately, you know, the other thing that made me, you know, certain that someone had just recently watched, you know, Herbie was that, the car that they get him is a VW Bug. And I was like, oh my God.
Right. Cause apparently they're filming on location and they fire him and he cannot fly back to Los Angeles. So the studio gives him a janky VW Bug.
She's arranged.
But like,
for
where was this movie Spy Dog even filming that you would drive down the coast in order to get back to Los Angeles?
Who knows?
Literally nowhere.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because like it's somewhere on the East Coast, right? So you would drive diagonally. Why would you drive straight down?
I don't know.
I don't know. I mean,
well, maybe it was in Oregon or something. You know,
the movie's not.
There is only
to
one road in Canada. We do know this.
Yeah. So. You know, the movie's not trying to be very accurate. We just know it's the East Coast because you see that one of the places is called Lobster Lane at one point.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh yeah. Must be in Maine or something. But
so we have evil Germans as well.
Mr. Bandersnatch. No, I'm kidding. They call him something different every time. What is his name?
Well, you know, it's Choose Your Own Adventure.
I think it's Brookschnauzer.
Brookschnauzer. Choose Your Own Adventure.
That's a Bandersnatch joke. Yeah, so he drives and ends up in a town for plot reasons that are unclear. And
just for a change of pace, hey, we got to have pirates in this one because it's about treasure.
His mechanic, who's played by David DeLuise, who himself has played many a doofy dad in many a thing, this time is just a doofy mechanic, not the doofy dad.
David DeLuise, doofy dad. Pleasure to meet you.
Nice to meet you, sir. Yeah, I don't know. He's in this town. It's the town is in trouble because the tourists aren't coming anymore to see all the, you know, the fancy pirate
scenery, but there's a boy who's about to die.
This is great because now we have fallen so far that you know, Beethoven now has like the $6 million man jump sound effect for when he's having a psychic moment.
So
it's like, yeah,
it randomly cuts to like this VW Bug breaks down in this town, and the guy's like, I don't well, what can I do, what's gonna happen? And he has like a really long boring conversation with the mechanic. But while that's happening, Beethoven goes out and lassies it up while there's this kid just hanging over the side of a fucking cliff.
Yeah. It's so funny. The kid, the whole time, the kid's like, go get a person. I need a human to help me. I'm about to fall. Get out of here, dog. Get someone else. And Beethoven's just like, no, it's me. I'm the one helping you. Here, take my leash.
I'm sorry, who? Do you mean Beethoven, the famous dog?
Oh, the famous dog. Yes.
Well, okay. Now, hold on. We go from a movie, previous movie in Christmas Adventure, where literally everyone is like, holy shit, it's Beethoven. And this one, like, no one recognizes him except for the kid.
Yeah. And every single time they say his name, John, what's his face, has to go, the famous dog.
Yeah. Because everyone's like, huh? When he says, you know, it's Beethoven. They're all like, oh, huh? Who's that? Which kind of, I don't know if Beethoven movies just aren't popular in the East Coast. I don't know.
It's too bad.
You think they would be. They do have more snow there.
That's true. That's true. But I just like the way that the mom, Christy Swanson, like discovers, realizes that her kid is, you know, missing or something. She's looking at all these maps on the wall and she's like, yes, there's 12 maps. And then she sees that one is missing. Then she like looks at it and goes, oh my God, the cliffs. And then just like runs off like my son. And you have no idea what's going on at all. And apparently
we have some of the most lazy screenwriting I've ever seen. There's apparently a Goonie style treasure buried underneath this town, where the owner of the bed and breakfast is the mother. The daughter of the owner of the bed and breakfast is the owner of the museum about the pirates. But there's disagreement about who is a pirate, who is not. And her son is actively trying to find the treasure. And that is the plot of the movie in a way.
Some
that
small town white people shenanigans.
Yep.
And none of these people are distinctive in any way whatsoever.
No.
I mean, how did he even end up over the cliff in that situation? What's he doing?
He was just looking for
attention.
He was
probably just looking at the map and doing the number of paces and not looking like where he was walking. Yeah.
He said he had, he had calculated out where he was supposed to be. So I don't understand why he would end up over the cliff.
I feel like that the most productive and entertaining route that we can take this podcast is to attack Justin for his hatred of the Goonies.
No. But yeah, the Goonies sucks. Don't watch it.
I have no opinion on the Goonies. I'm probably in the middle of you two.
I think he's actually right. I actually don't disagree so much. But this movie is treating the Goonies as if it is a pillar of cinematic excellence.
Yeah, but
this movie's just like not funny at all. The fact that trailer had the balls to call it the hilarious comedy is like so the most bald-faced lie I have ever heard. Like I did not laugh a single time during this movie, and most of the time I was like, like when something stupid happened.
Nothing signals going through the motions more than the 8th Beethoven sequel.
Yeah,
my God. Are there fart jokes in this movie? There sure are.
But they're not like the last movie. It was like,
no, they're not. No, the fart jokes are made in that they feel like that they have to honor the grand tradition of fart jokes,
which
like
there is the fart. Not. The they fart made that themselves.
Yeah, the fart jokes are tossed in out of obligation, as if the people who are making this movie are bored of them. I'm bored of them. The movie
everyone's
is bored
of fart jokes except for children.
It's so crass and so base. It's painful. This movie is painful.
Yeah. The only part that I thought was somewhat funny was the moment when they are showing this footage underneath the grandma explaining the story of her great grandfather, and she's like lovingly explaining like how he was this amazing adventurer, and then the footage they're showing is just totally undercutting her story completely with this gross pirate who's drinking, and you know the movie's rated PG, so there's all these like you guys drinking alcohol and stuff. It's not really funny, but I just thought it was kind of hilarious that the old lady was glowing about her story, and the truth was not.
It's
that.
Also like 10 years after Pirates of the Caribbean.
Oh, we'll talk about Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah.
So, oh, let's talk. Wait. Let's get into it.
Well, okay. Yeah. Do you want to get into it now?
What else are we going to talk about?
There's so much.
This movie, with its horrible covers, actually took Universal, 1440, Home Entertainment, actually, for some reason, was like, we're going to compromise every bit of integrity we have with the Beethoven franchise, but we cannot compromise when it comes to the cover of Yo-Ho, A Pirate's Life for Me in the end credits, because that says pirate more than anything else we could possibly do in this film. So fork the money over to Disney. We're doing it.
There's literally no other pirate songs that exist.
How about public domain sea shanties? Yeah. That would be free and a great idea.
Or just new sea shanties.
Yeah. They could make some stupid pirate song. Nobody cares. Like, why? I am shocked that they spent the money on this. And that
I didn't
Disney...
even think about this, and now I feel dumb. Like, they had to spend so much money.
Yeah.
It's not even like a song from a Disney movie. It is specifically written for the theme park attraction, you know, like, so they have to license it from like Disney theme parks, which is probably even different than the people that did the Pirates of the Caribbean movies. And like, you
more expensive or less expensive, Justin, if you just had to take a rough estimate.
Oh, I mean, it probably just goes. I don't know exactly, but it probably goes through Disney publishing and they just clear it, and I'm
right,
I would
which
be
is
shocked
super cheap, and they're not concerned about money at all.
Complicated would be my guess.
Yeah, I would be shocked that they wouldn't want to like hear the cover that is being used, and maybe they
well,
did,
and no one wants to hear this cover. So
yeah, I know
that alone is punishment.
A lot of times on huge songs like that, the publishers or whoever is signing off is going to want to hear like the recording beforehand, so they make sure it's a good recording and not like some shitty cover. And maybe in this, I don't know. Sometimes Disney stuff can be.
It seems like there was a lapse there.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, maybe they were just like, dump truck that money to Disney. We need to make this happen.
This would be like if Disney were to make Pirates of the Caribbean 8 and decided that they had to license Fallon Have a Tramtastic Day song, because
this
that's the only
Pirates
song I can think
Florida
of specifically
Keys.
Written for the parks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yo ho, yo ho.
I know. Yeah. I mean, it's
a pop punk life for me.
It is funny. It was specifically written for the parks, but it's definitely one of those songs that's like taken on a life of its own outside of just the ride, I feel. But
for sure.
Is there a song for the Jimmy Fallon ride? I've never been on it.
The Jimmy Fallon ride in Orlando, I don't know, but the tram in Hollywood at the end, he sings like, have a tramtastic day.
Oh,
have
God.
A tramtastic day. I don't remember
I
the rest
hate
of the words.
It so much.
Yeah.
Yeah. Burn it to the ground.
It's super weird. It was weird for them to cross studio lines like that. I didn't
Very
like
Very strange.
It. I didn't like it. And yeah, the cover is terrible by this band Diffuser, but guess what? That was the only song I could find, so it's going to be at the end of the episode. Woo!
Oh my God.
Wait, hold on. Was it the same band that did Secret Agent Dog?
No, that was Ali D. And also,
so
in the credits, it's just credited as Secret Agent
Man. Of two different expensive music covers that they were like, we need to organize this in such a way because it's essential to our story.
Well, yeah, because Diffuser can't do the Secret Agent Man sound. They're just like the heavy metal pop punk garbage sound of.
They sound identical, and if you told me that it was the producer's son,
they do not sound identical.
I would have believed it.
It was bad. Two different bands. I mean, maybe it's the same musicians. I have no idea. It's different band name. Who knows? It could be.
Yeah, the first band was from his freshman and sophomore year, and the second band was from junior and senior year.
The first band covers popular songs. The second band covers theme park songs.
That's right.
Diffuser. There's a different drummer sometimes. My God. Right, so there's a secret pirate treasure. There is a German who is trying to buy up and develop the town. There is a bed and breakfast.
There's an
that
extended
doesn't allow
sequence
pets. Yeah.
Of a prepubescent boy in a bubble bath where multiple people keep walking in, including Beethoven, who then gets in the tub with him.
Right.
Even after the boy says no.
Yeah.
Beethoven
which,
gets
you know,
in
just
anyways.
Wouldn't fly in 2020. That's a 2014 scene.
Yeah,
right there.
Yeah. I feel like
the consent.
Oh God. There's some funny. There's some not funny stuff, but there's like dumb things throughout the movie. There's a moment where Jonathan Silverman is like chasing after the guys who have, you know, allegedly stolen his dog, and he's running all over the city taking this girl's like bike, and he falls, he flips into this like smelly bucket of fish. And then
the amount, so the CG budget of this movie is for bits of food to fly up in front of the screen in the foreground and then fall down.
Yep. And if I'm not mistaken, regarding CG, I swear to God, Beethoven's eyes were CG at a certain point in the movie.
They were.
When they're like, we need it to look like the dog is looking at the bird at this moment, at the parrot at this moment. And I was like, ah, CG eyes. But anyways, back to the mackerel thing. He falls into this thing. And then I love that, like, for the next three scenes, all the background characters are like, have been told to act like this dude stinks real bad. So like, oh, the rest man. Of the scenes, there's people in the background like
entire podcast on the background actors in this movie, because they are not great.
No.
Well, I've got your child star check-in at some point.
Oh boy.
Do it. Do it now.
Do it let's now. Do, okay.
Let's do, so, yeah. Let's do the child.
Speaking of check-in. Little girl with bike.
She's Aaliyah. Now the prime minister of New Zealand.
Well, I mean, Aaliyah Arab or Arab, I'm not sure how they pronounce it, but little girl with bike, she recently graduated from high school and accepted an offer to Dalhousie University to earn her Bachelor of Science in Medical Science and to play on the women's basketball team, which she is very good at in Canada. And she recently was the valedictorian at her high school graduation, and she gave her speech about Black Lives Matter and what it was like growing up as a Black teen in Nova Scotia or wherever they are. And she hopes to become a doctor and to someday be a role model for other Black youth.
Nice. That's awesome.
So she was inspired by the crime of her bike being stolen by Jonathan Silverman.
Yeah. Even though he said and he was going to only borrow it for 10 minutes.
Yeah. So we also have Onika Drabble, who is one of the little girls that bullies him, the boy. And thankfully, she turned it around. She stopped bullying people and she became the captain of the high school lacrosse team and participated in cross country. And she ran 6,000 meters for a PR of 29 minutes and 7 seconds, which math, damn. But I think that's good.
Pretty good. Pretty good.
Yeah. And then finally, the girl that played Callie, the little girlfriend of the kid, sort of, Catherine Shore. I couldn't find what she's up to now, but I did find out that around the same time she was doing Beethoven, she worked for a company that casts and writes and films simulations for like training videos. So if you were like a Canadian corporation or a school and you were like, I need a video showing how to respond when someone sexually harasses you, or like, we need a video for our school about like what kids should do if a faculty member is grooming them, or, you know, stuff like that. She is specifically trained in acting for these simulation experiences.
That's cool.
That's awesome.
I'm sure there's some video of her saying, please don't touch me like that. I'm going to tell my parents or something.
Oh God. Oh God.
So, damn, should we pivot back to this movie, or let's just talk about literally anything else?
I have another.
I wrote one quote down that went once at one point when the woman is spurning his advances, he yells after her, in Hollywood, I'm considered a catch. And I'm like,
I'm tall.
You
is
are not
one of the things,
sir,
that he says. Yeah,
no,
he's not. Yeah, I was. Their whole relationship made no sense. Like, why It doesn't even make sense. Like, oh, just because he was like the only other single guy.
Yeah, she's just like, oh, a dude drove into town. Well, I must have a relationship with him then.
Yeah, they had no chemistry or anything.
They had no chemistry. And Christy Swanson is a heinous, MAGA, evil, like, person. And like, as of last night, she was tweeting her support for President Trump. Ugh. Like, I was like, this is like the worst person I've ever researched.
Well, they haven't counted all the votes yet.
Zero stars. Yeah. Jesus Christ. No. Oh God. That's terrible. Terrible. I had another note about hilarious background acting. There's a part in this movie. So the whole thing is like that the Brookschnauzer guy is going to, purchase the town and build like a shopping mall.
I will interject that Brookschnauzer was my most favorite part of this movie. It is the same actor who played Dr. Herbert West in Reanimator. And I think he might be the only person having fun in this movie.
Yeah, I didn't really like him. Sorry, Tyler. Sorry.
Me neither.
No. I think he was a piece of shit. I mean, I don't think anybody was good in this movie, but yeah. I feel like that he knows what movie he's in.
Yeah, maybe.
I was glad that it turned out that they were like fake the entire time and that he wasn't even really German. I was like, oh, good. Yeah. Now it all seems slightly less racist toward Germans.
Yeah. It was weird because his name was Fritz and everything. Yeah, it was.
It was still super racist towards Germans, and he was doing weird Hitler stuff the entire movie.
Yeah, it was not great. But I did enjoy the moment where he's showing off his, like in the last movie, we had the parade float paper mache thing. This one, he's got the shopping mall thing, and he gets to the point where he's like, and you've got your terrible rundown lighthouse, and here's what we're going to do. And he drops down this box over the lighthouse that says food court. And a bunch
it's
of
like
the people.
A three-story food court.
Yeah, and a bunch of the people in the audience that are like made up of, this is like everyone in the town is at this thing. A bunch of the people are like, oh, wow, yeah, food court. This is cool.
Are they going to get to the food court? They're going to hopscotch along the jagged rocks? Yeah. Like,
I don't know.
You hang over the side of the cliffs, and then Beethoven saves you, and then you can go get an Auntie Hems cinnamon pretzel.
I just couldn't believe that the people were like, yeah, this is a great idea. And it's only insane. the kid who's the only one who's like, no, we got to keep our history.
Everyone He's trying else. To buy and sell your town.
Yeah, don't look at this contract. He's got, the kid has the contract reading skills of Beethoven in this movie. He transferred them over to him, apparently.
I don't think that he had them before he was spending time with Beethoven. That's true. I think that Beethoven is,
taught him how to read.
I can't wait for Beethoven 9, where he just is
a lawyer
by a aspiring law student to hang out with him so he gets a larger understanding of contract law.
What if Beethoven 9 is Legally Blonde 3?
Oh, my God. Hollywood, get on the phone with us.
It's happening. But, the scene. Yeah, this movie. The scene of chaos that happens when the bird gets loose, the parrot gets loose in that town hall thing, and they show the same shot of Beethoven running through the audience past this boat like 5 times to make it look like these people are just like,
Justin,
I don't know.
I
just
challenge
so much
you to describe where this bird comes from.
The bird is, okay. So for some reason, for some reason at this museum, Christy Swanson has a real parrot that is
but
just there.
They're against being pirates. They're not pirates.
Well,
she's
that's,
not. Only her mom is.
Yeah, just her mom is like that because she thinks it sullies the family name. What was
Everybody
his name?
Else realizes it's the only way they can make money.
Patrick O'Malley or something like that?
Something dumb.
But yeah, so the parrot is just part of like the props of the of the museum, but it's a real parrot for some reason.
Yep. And does it talk? Am I wrong about that?
Yeah, does it does.
It does talk.
It speaks.
It's like, rah, sign on the dotted line.
Rah. Yeah.
Rah, Beethoven. Rah.
Yeah. I don't know. There's lots of dumb shit in this movie. there's a point where the kids, what's his name? Sam? Is it
Sam? Yeah.
He's like scouting out all the stuff at the this reception. And at one point he walks past this like, aquarium or something where there's a where there's a lobster and he just straight up picks it and grabs the lobster out. Yeah. I'm like, who would do that? Wouldn't you just look at it like, oh, cool, a lobster. You're not gonna like pick it up out of its like out of its thing. I don't know. There's dumb shit in this movie. That's all I gotta say.
He's an insane person. It's all contrived. And there's a point where the bad guy is dressed up as Captain Hook. There's a point where the bad guy is imitating Hitler. And this is all supposed to be a change of pace. Things are slowing down for Hollywood Beethoven and his trainer. And none of that actually works story-wise. Character wise, franchise wise, it's just let's just do a pirate movie. What, goddamn, 10 years after Pirates of the Caribbean?
Remember when Bindi Irwin's did that Free Willy pirate movie? That was so much better than this.
That was much better than this.
Yeah, and shot in a way cooler location.
Yeah.
Sorry, Nova Scotia.
Sorry. Yeah. The point is fuck you, Canada.
Aww.
With your socialized medicine and your delicious pizza.
Rebates for filming.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. So, in the end they find the treasure. I did think I did laugh really hard when the kid falls down that like shaft.
Corpse hole. Let's call it a corpse hole.
He's like, why would they lead us to his grave? That's stupid. There's nothing. He just like falls mid sentence, like through this.
He doesn't
giant
even think
hole.
To dig up the grave. Like,
yeah, it's so dumb. Like, obviously it's brought you there for some reason.
I really did want the tall man to come out and kill them both though.
Yeah, boy.
That was great. They do find the treasure, and the kid decides to be altruistic about it and give it to the people of the town.
I believe in the town.
This money's for the people.
He wants to give it to the cast and crew of the Ben Affleck movie, The Town.
This is for the town.
This is for the town.
I really liked that movie.
I really liked it, and I think that everybody should get paid. That's what I want to do with
this.
Does
anyone remember what town it was? Not me. Probably Boston.
It was Des Moines. Yeah.
It was Des Moines.
I honestly have so little to say about
this
movie.
That's it. That's note that I wrote down. And,
you know, like we said last week, there's not even a Wikipedia page for this movie because it's just like, meh. There's no reason. There's no reason to have it.
No, but I will say for an eighth film of a franchise that is widely known, I am surprised that they brought back characters. I am surprised that after the Christmas thing, they brought him back and that they tried to tie it together. I do think that his emotional phone call to his son is some of the better justification for characters not being involved that we've seen in this late in a franchise. And that is the only nice thing that I can say about
there just
movie.
Has to be some threshold though where you no longer get credit for doing that if it's executed so poorly.
Yeah.
I absolutely agree with that, but not on our fucking show because there's no threshold for like
let me
like,
just
it is so shameless. Like just the fact that they put the effort in to do that sets it apart from literally every other sequel that we've talked about this late in a series.
Let me just
I would have rather seen Beethoven go with that kid to college and like be in a frat.
I would have rather seen Beethoven be in heaven.
Beethoven being like, what? All dogs go to heaven for.
All Beethovens go to heaven.
Yeah.
Let me just call my off-screen son that I totally didn't murder because he was bugging me all the time about my job. He's definitely at college, guys. He's definitely at college. Right,
okay, so like,
even though the photo I have of him is as a child, I don't have any adult.
If this movie had more stories or more content, it would have been the first scene to be cut.
Yeah. They don't need that moment. It's done.
But it wasn't, and so it addressed a lot of complaints that we have with 8 sequels, because we're literally talking about the 8th movie in the Beethoven series.
Yeah. Well, hey, we're hating on this movie, but I pulled up this week's Common Sense Media page for the movie.
I purposefully did not click on this because I wanted to be surprised.
There's one review that is confusing, but it says it's from a parent of a... It says parent of a
pirate,
pirate of a 6 and 8 year old. No, parent of a 6 and 8 year old. And the subject is, I want to see it again. 5 stars. And then the review actually says, so it said that it's a parent, right? The review says, I am 8 years old and I loved it. It was adventurous and thrilling, which sounds like a fake review. Like, well,
I am, eight years old, and I also produced this movie and 30 other Universal 1440 movies this year.
So, yeah. So wait, you telling me you're an 8 year old parent of 6 and 8 year old? Because that's how it reads. I'm not buying it. But here's the you know, they have lots of questions to talk to your kids about. Here's the one this week that I thought was the funniest. You're supposed to talk to your kids. Why was Beethoven fired from his quote unquote job? What do you think caused his sadness? And how did the events of the movie bring back his spark?
It didn't.
Yeah.
Like, it really didn't.
They just put him right back into making movies at the end.
It got the dad laid, maybe?
Hard to say.
Yeah.
But certainly he was able to bring his love interest on as an AD. So that's really the romance story that we want to see. At the end of this movie, he's like, we're going to make our own movies on... over here.
Yeah, and grandma's a PA.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I thought the whole thing was that Beethoven didn't want to make movies anymore, and here he is at the end being forced to make movies again. This is his hell loop. He's in hell.
I don't know if it's interesting at all. In hell. But...
He's like, no matter what adventure I take my owner on, he always makes me make movies at the end of it.
I think this is one of the first ones where Beethoven is played by like 3 or 4 different dogs, too.
Oh,
and they look wildly different.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not a good movie. Not a good movie.
It's real bad.
So Tyler, we should do a ranking, but then we should also do a franchise order.
Yes. Which is going to be a whole fucking thing. All right.
So many movies.
How many lighthouse dioramas would you give Beethoven's 8th, The Treasure Tale? T-A-I-L.
Treasure Trail. I think I'm going to give it a 2, but maybe a 1.
Yeah, I'm so close to a 1, but I usually save 1 for like something abhorrent with like a bunch of rapes and racism.
I think I got to give it a 2 because like at least it was, I was like, at least they tried to do something different. I mean, it's not good. I wouldn't watch this movie.
You couldn't pay me to watch this movie. If you put a gun to my head to watch this movie,
we're definitely
I would
not.
Contemplate you daring you to pull the trigger.
Whoa. Hey, we didn't do that. You watched it on your own accord. And we're definitely not getting paid. So
fucking do it.
Bad movie. Don't watch it. The end. Next.
Elis.
Yeah, I'm going to give it 2, just barely escaping a 1, because it really made me angry. And it was just dumb. And I just, they brought back the worst character from Beethoven's Big Break only, and nothing else. And it's just like the worst possible scenario. Like, in my head, we talked about how on the back of the DVD, the Christmas movie is actually listed last, and this is before it. I want to just headcanon that Beethoven managed to escape this horrible dog trainer and then go have this Christmas adventure and then ultimately just live with Santa.
Yeah, he's living with Tim Allen as we speak.
Yeah, exactly.
So he's just in the North Pole and living out his days, not being forced to make movies with this horrible man.
He's teaching Santa not to be racist.
Mm-hmm. No, he's not a stable elf. Yeah, I will also go to, this movie was not egregiously offensive, but it was terminally boring.
Yep.
And for I really try to find positives about it, and I think that there are some for our poor, unfortunate souls that have had to watch so many goddamn sequels. But this 8 movies, we're talking about 8 movies. Man, I guess we're gonna get into the series ranking, but this is a special type of sequel rights, and I guess we will get into that. Elis, I'm gonna direct towards you. Where do you think that the whole franchise shapes up?
Yeah, I am ready to give you my order here. I have some hot takes because, you know, we talked about this with the second one. I really, really love that second one. So that, to me, is my favorite, is Beethoven's second. Then, of course, the original Beethoven, close behind.
Second one is the road trip one?
No, the second one is the babies and the original family still.
The third one is the road trip.
Oh, right. That's with the rich family.
No. You're skipping
the original
so many
family from Beethoven 1. Beethoven has puppies with Missy, and then they
got
go to
it.
Lake House.
Got it.
Debbie
got
Mazar.
It.
Yeah,
yep,
yeah.
Yep, 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 yep.
College drunk teens being dumped in a lake.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes. Beethoven destroys an entire cabin.
Yes. Okay. So that's my favorite. Then original. Then I'm going to say Christmas, okay?
Like, yeah. My God.
The magic of Christmas is next in third place for me. Then I'm going to say Big Break, due just to like Stephen Tobolowsky and the Hollywood in jokes and like the meta-ness of it. Then I'm going to say 4, which was the rich family, poor family, greeting card guy.
It wasn't even 3.
Then I'm going to say 3, which was the hideous road trip. And then finally, Oh, no, I messed up. Shit. Okay, so Christmas, Big Break, making the movies, then Beethoven's 5th, the old town of mercury poisoning with the treasure and the little girl. Then I'm going to say 4, because I just... Judge Reinhold, Julia Sweeney, hate them so much. So 4 and 3, those are their 2. And then I'm going to end with this one, The Treasure, because it is just so nothing.
Yeah. Oh, man.
So, yeah, 2-1, Christmas, Big Break, 5-4-3, Treasure is my order.
I can't tell if it's because I don't have a strong opinion about this or because... No, it feels like that. I completely agree with that ordering. Like, I don't have a counter argument to it.
You wouldn't put the original first?
I think I would put the original first. Just
maybe?
For more. I have more nostalgia for that than the second movie. For me. The original.
Okay, do yours, Justin.
Oh, I was just looking at my list and noticed that I don't know if this has happened in other franchises, but I have multiple movies with the score of 1. So that's not great for good old Beethoven. But yeah, I would do Beethoven 1, Beethoven 2, and then I think I got to agree with you to like leap all the way to the Christmas Adventure.
Maybe because it's just because it's Christmas right now, yeah, so we're in the spirit.
I think
no,
that's
I think it absolutely
right.
is, but it also gets it out of there. Yeah,
and then, I think according to my list here, I would have to do Beethoven's 3rd, the road trip one, and then Big Break, and then, I put Treasure Tale as a 2. And then it would be, I really didn't like Beethoven's 4th. And then the last one, I really didn't like the Quicksilver one, Beethoven's 5th. Boom.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
I think I'm going to agree with Elis, but just put the first movie up front.
Yeah, that's good. I like it. We watched 8 Beethoven movies.
I will say that going through 8 movies, which is one of our longer endeavors, does give me a greater respect for the Chucky franchise and how many innovative and fun movies are in that franchise.
Mm-hmm.
Where this is the most derivative, the most spread thin franchise I think we've ever done. Just because there's 8 movies.
Yeah. Do you guys think they could turn it around with a 9th movie?
Here's the thing. The reason that we're doing these Beethoven movies is because we did the Benji movies, and also, like, there's no fucking question that Benji is superior to Beethoven.
Oh my god.
But no, like we're doing pet movies. Like, there is a genre of sequels, and I think that you could make a great Beethoven movie right now, and it would require going back to you could honestly probably make the best Beethoven movie right now.
It needs reboot or a full reset to the second one. Like, one of the kids from the original family is now an adult with kids, and they are hesitant to get a dog because they think no one can replace Beethoven in their heart, but yet there's some Saint Bernard that's going to be killed, so they adopt it and then learn to re-love Saint Bernards. That's my pitch. Like,
and the kid doesn't realize how much work it actually was.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the seriously probably the main holdup of this movie is why it hasn't happened yet is because the suits around the table are probably like, okay, we really need to reboot the movie, but we can't also, like, we shouldn't pass up the opportunity to call it Beethoven's Ninth. But we don't want people to know that there's been 9 movies, because if we call it Beethoven's Ninth, people are going to be like, I don't want to watch a fucking 9th Beethoven movie. That's dumb. But they also don't want to give away the opportunity to call it Beethoven's Ninth, because, I mean, I think that's a great...
Just call the dog 9. German for no.
Beethoven's 9th.
Yeah. Or like the family has 9 kids or something insane like that, or Beethoven has 9 puppies, or you know what
I was thinking about, cheaper by the ninth. I was like, we had this will be a couple weeks ago now, but we had that big announcement of Disney Plus and all these related TV shows, and I was like, where's the Universal Plus streaming service where we get, like, you know, spin-off shows of Beethoven and
Peacock.
That's true. Peacock, but I feel like they're not doing that. They should do it.
No, they should. I mean, yeah, you're absolutely right. It's like, where's the Heavyweight show? Where's the fucking Beethoven? It's coming. Don't worry.
I would love
also, if anybody would like to work on those pitches with me, just send us an email.
Hey, my Beethoven's Ninth pitch is already great.
It's pretty good.
It's heartfelt. The dog brings the family together. See, I'm a professional screenwriter, just like that lady.
Just like that lady that was completely ignored and dismissed.
I feel like they might just pull the trigger on Beethoven's Ninth and then plan a reboot after that.
Could be. Beethoven X.
Beethoven X.
Beethoven X. I don't know why, but the X-Men, the animated series theme just started playing in my head.
We've reanimated Beethoven's body and put...
Hey, reanimator. Let's... Jeffrey Combs in this movie. Combs. It's kind of fun in this movie. I don't know. I like seeing him.
Yeah. And if you're even a better person than us, I'm pretty sure that Beethoven the animated series is actually on Peacock. I didn't check, but I know I heard another podcast where they mentioned that they looked at it on Peacock.
Oh, wow. Yikes. It's probably terrible. I watched the animated theme song.
It might be better than
today.
This movie, though.
Yeah. That's true. It's closer to the original, film.
Yeah.
So. Well, I think that's going to be the end. That's our last episode for the year, for 2020.
That's a wrap on 2020. That's a wrap on Beethoven.
I hate to end with a puppy whimper, but yeah, this one was real bad. But, you know, overall, Beethoven, everybody knows him still for some reason, and it had to be done.
You know what this has done? In a way that I like, completely uncynically, Benji is a marvel. Like, the Benji series is something that is incredibly special, and that I don't think that we gave enough credit to, which we did. We adored it as we were watching through it, but it's not something I ever would have gone through and enjoyed if it wasn't for this podcast. And I mean, at the end of 8 Beethoven movies, The only advice I can give you is go back and watch a Benji movie.
Yeah, I mean, if we took a drink every time we thought, wow, I really wish I was watching Benji instead, or wow, Benji yeah. did that so much better during the Beethoven series, we'd be dead. So, yeah.
I mean, that's basically where I'm at recording this episode this evening. So.
I mean, yeah, the first Benji movie is like, you know, is like an art house Criterion collection.
It's a masterpiece.
It's really good. Yeah. 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 It's really good.
Go watch it. Even the Christmas special for Benji. Just
other than the blackface.
Just enjoy.
Well,
that
what Christmas special doesn't have some racial insensitivity yeah, these days?
Apparently, even that last one that was 2011. Ugh.
Yeah. Anyway, so we are going to be heading into 2021. Elas, let people know where they can get in touch with us, because we need new franchises. We've had our cycles of action and horror and animal and whatever else there is. Feel like that we're actually getting into a little bit of cycle of that. If there is some franchise that you feel like that is untapped, that is outside of the genres you've already covered, we would love to talk about it.
Yes.
So
yes,
please,
equal rights.
Send us an email
at gmail.com and on social media on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube at Sequel Rights. And maybe I'll even upload some more of those recordings to YouTube over the Christmas break.
Nice.
And please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts. 5 stars goes a long way to having other people find us.
That's right. And so we'll be back in January, and we hope that you guys have a great holiday break and enjoy the holidays, keeping safe out there this holiday season. You know, I know a lot of people aren't able to be with their families to be safe, and we just hope that, you find some way to enjoy the time as best you can.
Thanks Absolutely. For listening in 2020. Yeah. I mean, I hope we brought you at least a smile or laugh here and there. I mean, I know even just doing the podcast like has helped me keep some semblance of time and a weekly
Absolutely.
Cycle and schedule. So, you know, it was tough there in the middle. We got a little antsy around Bring It On, but we came back and, we had Justin's paternity leave. We made it through that, and we're good to go in 2021. So stick with us.
Is there an episode I would like to point people toward, like an episode this year of just like, hey, if you're listening to this now and you missed something, I would like to point people towards our Herbie episodes.
Michael Gross, Tremors, Shaker Island.
Yep. Absolutely.
And Alexa Penavega in Spy Kids 3. Those were our two biggest interviews this year.
That was huge.
You guys had a great, the podcast had a great year.
We really did.
And I'm really proud of, despite having to record remotely and everything else that we did, like we put together some of our best episodes this season, and
making it happen,
kind of awesome.
Yeah, lots to go back and enjoy. So please do it and let us know what you're digging, and we'll see you guys again soon in a few weeks
in the bright future of 2021.
That's right. It's gonna be amazing, hopefully. We'll see you.
Build me, cuddle me, rifle and loot, stand up me, arms go ho. We kidnap and ravage and don't give a hoot, stand up me, arms go ho. And sack stand out me, hearty yo ho. Marauding and embezzling, even hijack stand.